Hello, today we shall study the ring and travelers. So let us look at what are the parameters for ring. It's the ring diameter and the flange width. So this is the ring and this is the cross section of the ring, where one can see how the cross section looks like. It is like this. If this ring were to cut it to half, this is the cross section. So rings are fixed by screws on the ring rail and are centered around a spindle. The ring has a flange that projects at right angles from both the sides of the top edge. So this is the ring, and if we were to cut it, this is the cross section of that ring, this shape. And the ring has a flange that projects at right angles from both the sides of the top edge. So rings are available with inside diameter in the 36 to 57 mm range, and these are the flange numbers and along with the flange widths. So if the flange number was 1, the flange width in mm would be 3.2 and so on. So as a number increases, the width also would increase in mm. So if we were to show it in the form of a sketch, this is the cross section of the ring and this is the flange width. Whereas from here onwards, the diameter, whatever the diameter of the ring would be there, that could be from 36 mm to 57 mm. So with this, we look at the ring material. The ring must be hard on the exterior. The running surface must have a high hardness, 800 to 850 wickers. The surface smoothness, it should be very high, but it should not be so much that it does not allow the building of the lubricating film. Now let us look at what the lubricating film is. While processing cotton, some of the projecting fibers along with the wax are scraped off by the traveler. The crushing of these fibers and wax due to the centrifugal force or the friction of the traveler, it builds up a lubricating film on the ring surface, and that helps in the smooth running of the traveler on the ring. So whenever cotton is being processed, one can expect a small layer of lubricating film to be developed because of the crushing of some of the projecting fibers, and also because of the high centrifugal force and the friction and the heat generated and in this area, one can fibers, they get converted into a lubricating film which gets deposited on the ring surface, and it helps in the smooth running of the traveler on the ring. Yarn fineness, raw material, traveler mass, traveler speed and traveler bow height, all these factors influence the formation of the lubricating film. So traveler speeds are kept low while processing fine yarns because the centrifugal force is low due to the low traveler height. So whenever fine yarns are being processed, one needs to keep a low traveler weight so that it does not put a lot of tension into the yarn and break them. So because of this low traveler weight, one would see that the centrifugal force is also less. And because of this centrifugal force being less amount of film is being generated or created on the ring surface. And because of that, one has to automatically go for a lower traveler speed. So therefore, there is hardly any buildup of lubricating film and traveler speeds need to be kept low. So flame or induction hardened steel, nitride steel, carbonitride steel, which is more commonly used, and chrome steel, which might be rarely used. These are the materials used to make the ring. So with this, let us look at the traveler parameters. We have just seen the ring. So this is the ring, which is seen as a cross section over here. And on this, there is a small clip-like element that is there, which is known as a traveler. So the ring flange is a track for the traveler to run on it. So this flange we have just seen, on this flange, this traveler would be running. And the yarn would be running in between the ring surface, the flange and the traveler. So these are this is the sketch of a traveler, and these are the various parameters that are labeled and which we shall see one by one. This dotted line is the ring outline of the, that is a cross section of the ring. So one here is the inner width of traveler. So one that is marked here, if this is the one, and it is the inner width of the traveler. Height of bow, so 2 is height of bow, which is marked here. From the base of the traveler to the topmost position of the traveler is the height of bow. Then one has a position of yarn path. So yarn would be, if this is the flange, and if we were to know which side it is going, then in that case, this particular yarn would be passing in between the ring and the traveler. And then this is the wire section, 4 marked here. So one can see the cross section of the wire out of which this traveler is shaped. Then you have the ring contact surface, which is marked as 5. And that is this, where the ring is actually coming in contact with the traveler surface. Then the angle of toe, which is marked as 6, and that is this angle of toe. 7 is the toe, and 8 is the toe gap, that is a gap between two toes. And 9 is the upper part of the bow. So this 9 marked here is the upper part of bow. So we have seen all the traveler parameters here. And with this, let us look at the limitation on the traveler speed. The traveler, as it is running on the ring surface with a very high speed, it will have a lot of centrifugal force or force that is there on the traveler, which is trying to push it out. And this force would be to an extent of 35 newtons per millimeter square, and which would amount to around 3.5 kilogram force. And therefore, it's quite high that way. If one has to imagine 3.5 kilograms being rotated at a speed of 25,000 RPM around the spindle. And this centrifugal force would be calculated in this manner. It is equal to traveler mass into traveler velocity square divided by ring diameter. So due to this kind of high centrifugal force acting on a traveler during running, the traveler is pressed against the ring. Every time the traveler would be pressed against the ring surface, this results in friction and heat generation. So as soon as it is pressed, it will definitely lead to friction as well as a lot of heat generation. The heat generated has to be dissipated. That means the whatever the heat is generated, it has to be transferred to other surfaces, and somehow that level of heat should be brought down. Due to the small mass and contact area of the traveler with the ring, the heat is not dissipated in the available time, resulting in the limitation of the traveler speed. So because the mass is too small, the traveler, as we've seen, is very small as compared to the other parts of the ring frame. And also the contact area, the traveler would be touching the ring at say one place on the ring, and because of that, even heat by conduction is not possible. And even if it is possible, it is to a very small extent, and heat is not therefore dissipated in the limited amount of time that it has, and which will therefore result in the limitation of the traveler speed. So traveler speed cannot be increased beyond a certain limit because of this lot of amount of heat generated due to friction. So at normal speed, the ring temperatures may go around 5 to 10 degrees above the normal atmospheric temperature. But when you compare this with the traveler temperature that it achieves, that may go well above 300 degrees Celsius. And therefore, also due to poor dissipation of heat, this is what is happening, that the traveler may reach even 300 degrees Celsius during its running. So let us look at the traveler mass. The traveler mass, as we have seen now from the formula, it is directly proportional to the frictional forces between the traveler and the ring, because centrifugal force is directly proportional to traveler mass, and that will in turn result in frictional forces, which is directly proportional between the traveler and the ring, and it influences the winding as well as the balloon tension. So if the mass is too small, then there will be a low yarn tension with a big balloon. So if you were to use a small mass for the traveler, then the balloon size would be too high, and because of the low tensions in the yarn, and the cop that we will be getting would be too soft, and also the amount of material wound on the bobbin will be very low. So therefore, if we were to go for higher traveler mass, on the other hand, it would lead to high yarn tensions and higher end breakages. So if a choice is available between two traveler weights, that means if I have a choice where I can use a lower traveler weight or a higher traveler weight, then usually a heavier one is selected since it gives better cockpit because it will increase the amount of yarn that can be wound, and also because it helps in smoother running of the traveler without fluttering, and also because of heat dissipation. If the traveler is heavy, it will give a better contact with the ring and better heat dissipation. So therefore, if there is a choice between the two, then it's better to go for a heavier traveler. And especially this heat dissipation effect is there, whatever is there with a heavier traveler, it is more useful for synthetic fiber spinning. So in the ISO standard system of expressing traveler mass, traveler number is defined as a weight of 1000 travelers in grams. So it is defined as weight in grams of 1000 travelers. So this is a rough table which can give you a rough idea about say what kind of traveler number could be used on for which yarn fineness. So traveler number, as we know, it is a weight in grams of 1000 travelers. So we have here the traveler numbers that are given. Now 9 means that 9 grams is the weight of 1000 travelers. If we go along the column here, we find that the traveler goes on becoming heavier, because for the same 1000 travelers, now here the weight is 100. So now let us compare this with the yarn fineness. It is given in techs here. Let us look at this column first. So in techs, whenever I say 5 techs, 5.567, we know that the yarn is becoming coarser along the column. So as the yarn is becoming coarser, one can see the traveler number or the traveler weight is also increasing. So for a coarser yarn, one needs to use a heavier traveler. So with this, as the yarn spun is coarser, traveler weight increases. Also, another observation we have over here is when we compare synthetic and blends with cotton here, we see that suppose any number we take this particular text, 30 sticks. So 30 texts, the cotton, for the cotton, we are using a 90 traveler number. That is 90 is the weight in grams of 1000 travelers. But at the same time, for the same 30 texts, we are using 100 traveler number for synthetic and blends. As we have mentioned earlier, it is better to use a heavier traveler because it will help in better heat dissipation, and because of that, a heavier traveler for the same count is preferred whenever we are spinning synthetics and blends. So a heavier traveler is used for synthetic yarns of same fineness. So with this, we can look at the indirect system of traveling traveler number. And in indirect system, traveler number is 1 if the weight of 10 travelers is 10 grains. So it is 2 if the weight is 11 grains, and so on. So as the traveler number, as we can see, as it's going from 1 to 2, what is happening is the weight is 11 grains. That means the weight is going on increasing as the number goes on increasing. But traveler number, when we say 1/0, if the weight of the traveler, 10 travelers is 9 grains, then it is 1/0. That means it is going on the negative side. If it is 2/0, the weight is 8, and so on. It goes on reducing as we put a /0 in front of the number. So one can see over here for a 16th yarn count. Here it is given in English count here. What we see here is from 16 to 20, it goes on, the yarn is going on becoming finer. So logically, when the yarn is becoming finer, we need to go for a lighter traveler, and exactly that is what is being is happening or is shown over here in the table. From traveler number 2, it is going on the negative side, 2/0, then 3/0. So whenever we say /0, it is going on the, it is like a negative yarn numbering system where it is going on the negative side, where the weight goes on reducing for a finer yarn count. So as the yarn spun is finer, the weight of the traveler weight or the weight of the traveler decreases. Shape of the traveler. Let us look at the shape of the traveler. Now, what kind of shape is expected? The shape of the traveler must exactly coincide with the flange of the ring. The traveler must have only one contact surface with the ring, and it should be as large as possible. So wherever it has a contact with the ring, it should be one, and the contact should be as large as possible so that one is able to dissipate as much heat as possible. The top of the traveler arc must be as flat as possible, leaving sufficient space for the yarn passage. So one must take care that there is enough space for the yarn to go in between the traveler and the ring, so that the center of gravity is low, allowing smooth running. Both these factors, that is contact surface and the center of gravity, influence the speed that can be achieved. So both, if the center of gravity is low, one can get smooth running, and the speed may be increased. At the same time, if there is a large contact area between the ring and the traveler, again the speeds can be increased, because one can expect higher heat dissipation, and higher speeds can be achieved. So, but at the same time, if we are going to look at the reducing the center of gravity for allowing us to go for smooth running, one must also take care, as mentioned, that the space should not be too small over here. Too small a space would lead to increased hairiness, because the yarn would brush against or rub against the traveler, and it would generate a lot of fiber fly. It would increase the hairiness of the yarn, and also it would deteriorate the quality of the yarn. In case of man-made fibers, it is more serious, because it will also lead to the formation of melt spots or melt points. So now with this, let us look then what kind of material should we use so that we get a good traveler performance. The traveler should therefore generate as little heat as possible, quickly distribute the heat to the entire traveler, dissipate the heat to the ring and air. The material must be elastic so that a traveler can be pressed on the ring without breaking. It should also display high wear resistance, and also have a slightly lower hardness, that is 650 to 700 as compared to the ring, since the traveler must wear out rather than the ring. It's better that the traveler wears out, because the traveler is a small piece. It is cheaper and it is also easier to replace if it wears out as compared to the ring. Ring is a bigger piece. It would be more expensive to replace the ring in case it is damaged because of wear. So it's better to go for a softer traveler, which will wear out faster as compared to the ring. So now we come to the impact on the yarn quality. The ring and the traveler have an impact on yarn quality, but they cannot improve the quality of the fiber strand coming from the rafting system. So one must always remember that it can always affect negatively on whatever quality is being spun, but definitely it cannot undo all the defects in the yarn that are already there. So whatever quality of fiber strand that is already coming out from the rafting system, it cannot improve it, but at least it will not deteriorate further if care is taken at the ring and traveler stage. So ring and traveler can have following impact. First one is a yarn hairiness, and if there is yarn hairiness, one must go for checking the wear condition and the centering of the ring. Then also one can look for traveler weight. If the traveler weight is too low, the yarn balloon would bulge automatically, and the increased friction on the balloon control ring increases yarn hairiness. So if there is a lot of yarn hairiness, one must go for a heavier traveler weight, so that it will reduce the balloon size and therefore reduce the friction of that yarn along the balloon control ring. Also, one can look at the choice of right shape of ring and traveler to reduce the yarn hairiness. What this means is maybe the space between the ring and the traveler is too less, and because of which yarn hairiness is increased. So selecting the right shape of ring and traveler is also important. So coming to the next effect on the yarn quality is the neps, and therefore the CV percentage. And this happens specifically because of push-up neps that develop on the traveler. So if neps are too high, then one must look for the reasons here, like unsuitable traveler maybe, then heavy worn out traveler. So these might be the two reasons why lot of neps are generated. Then the third impact is the yarn breaks during spinning. So ring and traveler can also impact to a large extent the breaks that happen during spinning. And one of the factors that is responsible is traveler weight. Traveler weight must be selected in such a manner that the yarn tension is minimum and therefore does not lead to end breakages at the spinning triangle. But it should not be so low that it poses a problem due to excessive bulging and friction at the balloon control ring. So traveler weight, although it can help, one can say increase the yarn tension or decrease the yarn tension depending on how much breakages it is giving. If it's giving too a large number of breakages, one may go for a reduced yarn tension, therefore reduced weight, by reducing the weight of the traveler. But at the same time, we must remember that as soon as we reduce the weight of the traveler, it will give you another sort of problem, that is, it will lead to excessive bulging of the balloon, and a lot of the large balloon would lead to a friction at the balloon control ring. So the selection of the traveler weight must be done very carefully, and it should be optimum, so that the it does not introduce a lot of tension and a lot of yarn breakages, and at the same time it should not allow a lot of bulging in the balloon size, which would lead to a lot of friction at the balloon control ring. So it should be a very careful selection of the traveler weight. So with this, let us look at the working of the traveler. The traveler actually imparts twist to the yarn, that is the first function of the object of the traveler, as we know, and it is also responsible for winding the yarn on the cob. So it performs these two functions, that is imparting twist and winding. So how does it do this winding or twisting? We know how it does, because it will, because of the rotation of the traveler over on the ring, one rotation of the traveler will insert one twist into the yarn. So let us look at the function of winding. The length of the material that is delivered by the front roller has to be wound on the bobbin, so which is mounted on the spindle. So winding, so for winding to happen, there must be difference between the peripheral speeds of the spindle and the traveler. We know that whenever winding has to take place, there has to be a difference in speed between the one that the element that is going to wind the material and the element on which the winding is happening. So only and only if there is a difference between these two elements will the winding take place. So in this case, the one that is winding is the traveler, and the element on which the winding is happening, that is actually the spindle or the bobbin that is mounted on this spindle. So if there is a difference between spindle and traveler, only then the winding will take place. So for this winding to take place, the traveler, we know that it does not have any kind of positive drive. So unlike on the speed frame, where there was a positive drive to both the flyer as well as the bobbin, in this case the traveler does not have a positive drive, and it is only running by lagging, and it lags behind the spindle always. It is carried along by the rotation of the bobbin mounted on the spindle. So whenever the bobbin that is mounted on the spindle rotates along with the spindle, this traveler will be carried along with it. But it will always be having a speed which is lower than that of the spindle, because it will be lagging behind the spindle speed, and it is only being rotated because of the connection that the thread has between the traveler and a bobbin. So whenever the, if you look at the thread line that comes, it comes, the material comes from the front roller roller, and from the front roller nip it goes on towards the lappet, and from the lappet it will go through the ring and traveler space, and it will be wound on the bobbin. So the thread that is there between the traveler and the bobbin, that will help in pulling the traveler along on the ring. So because of this, the traveler is actually rotating, and one can easily understand that the traveler will always be lagging behind the speed of the spindle. So what if x is the speed of the spindle, traveler would be having a speed something lower than x, that is x minus something. So it will always run by lagging. So with this, we come to the end of this lecture. Thank you.